Hello, welcome back for another Knights and Merchants Shellcast. I am going to apologize out front. I will be coughing a lot probably during this recording, but I do want to get a little bit more content out there, and this cough has been lasting for weeks with no end in sight. So I have a beverage to help control the coughing. But if the day continues, or the weeks continue going as they have been, I will continue coughing as I continue talking. Anyway, just want to get that aside. Right off the bat, we have here another matchup between Mex T and Koczis. There is indeed another video on my channel showing these two duking it off, Mex pulling out the crossbowman and showing Koczis he can win even with the inferior unit composition. But don't let that alarm you or sway your thoughts on Koczis. He's definitely a competent player, and he can show Mexican what he's worth, and hopefully he does just that this game. At least that is what he's hoping, and if you're rooting for Koczis, then you also are hoping for it. Anyway, we will there's the first cough. We'll be going over their builds and discussing anything unusual they might be doing, and I will also try to explain, to the best of my knowledge, what players are doing, why they are doing it, and perhaps actions that could have gone a different way if they had done it in a different manner. Now here right away, you may notice that Mex can put a woodcutter here with no trees around. This is very much okay because his sawmill just now was able to be constructed, and he has 4 or 5 more trees than he would have if he put his woodcutter up here. His sawmill gets to work at the same time, but he's got some trees that will be cut down soon in the future. We call this a planter, if you don't know so already. The planter will ensure that you have trees in the future to be cut, and is always a good idea on difficult locations where you have fewer trees than normal, or at least on other maps. And you will see another planter being placed here by Mexican. The idea is that these trees will be cutting, or these woodcutters will be harvesting trees by the time this guy and this guy run out, and to ensure that his wood production is not hindered or halted on any matter. Let's look at Koczis' base real quick. You can see the players are basically neck and neck. Although saying that, Koczis does actually have to. Looks like he has the better start. 3 farms already. Mexican just getting his second one up. Don't see any other differences, so Mexican seems to be doing a bit better. Although it's worth saying that this location is undoubtedly more difficult. And yeah, you can see Koczis is securely ahead at the moment as he does have his iron mine up and almost his iron smithy. Mexican can't even boast an iron mine at the moment. I wonder if Mexican realizes how short he is on iron, because he's already going for a second iron mine. I don't know if this is normal behavior by him, going for a second iron mine so quickly. It is worth knowing that a iron mine works a bit slower than one iron smithy, so it's a good idea to get your second iron mine up quickly anyway. But saying that, I do see that he is already building a second iron smithy anyway. So he's probably hoping to get caught up on iron. He's got 5 coal mines now. If I can count, he has 5, and Koczis is just now getting his 5th. Even though Koczis already has his weapon production going, I don't doubt that Mexican will be able to catch up with his heavy focus on iron right now. For 5th farm going up, Koczis already has his 5th farm and 2nd swine farm on the way. Mexican can't boast 2 swine farms yet, but he will be making a stable momentarily. I have no doubt that Mexican's production will catch up. It's a strategy I've seen him go for time and time again. where it looks like he's fallen behind on one thing, but it's because he's had to focus on something else. In this case, getting his wood production up in this area. That's a long road, and he's tried to capitalize that on building his farms on the way to these trees. And in any case, you can see that he's got his second iron smithy running, or armor smithy working. And these are stocked nicely and will continue working unhindered for a while, whereas Koczis, his are suffering a little bit, despite getting them up and running sooner. I would say they're still neck and neck, even though Koczis looked like he was skewerly ahead for a while. He's got already enough armor for 6 soldiers. And Mexican is really close to that as well. His barracks being constructed right now too, and Koczis not even getting that started. Well, the road has started. So yeah, you can see, even though Mexican's production was, it looked a little delayed, all is going according to plan. Still 2 sawmills, really? Okay, he's got 3 right here, it is. 3 sawmills, this is good. He's going to need that because wooden weapon production starting very soon. There it is, right there. And unfortunately, Koczis does not have his weapons workshop running. Mexi really did have a boost there around 15 minutes ago, where his base really exploded. And I'm interested in observing that in closer detail later. Perhaps I'll open up this replay and look a little bit more on exactly what it is that caused that big boom. He had 2 or 3 farms pop up really quickly, and all his armor production went up really fast, and it's working marvelously well. And let's pause this real quick, and we'll try to figure out why it is that Mexi's armor production is working so nicely. These are staying completely stocked, which is going to be great considering his weapon smithy is going to start working. So there's going to be no problem with these guys pounding out the swords. 15 minutes left to go, so they do need to work hard and fast. Only 2 armors, iron smithies? Okay, so he is going to want to get a... No, there's a third. Why am I blind? Am I... Just can't see? Yeah, right here. Oh my goodness. Anyway, let's look and see, compare this to Koczis' base. What's going on here? Why is the iron production so much better for Mexican? Can we see something? Well, we see Koczis doesn't have his third iron smithy up, and not even his third iron mine, and that'll do it alone right there. We also need to consider that Mexi had his iron smithies up, or 2 iron smithies up, much sooner than Koczis. So here's an example of a time where even though Koczis had his production up sooner, the inefficiencies and not having the proper amount of facilities set up to support the weapons, wasn't able to keep pace with Mexi, even though these were delayed a bit. Even when Koczis gets his third iron smithy up, it's not going to be running at maximum efficiency because his iron mine is going to be going up around the same time. And I think that's all there is to it. It's just that his third iron smithy is not here yet, and Mexi having a second one up so early was able to keep this iron production going so smoothly for so long. We'll look at the weapons and see that indeed they are neck and neck overall. This is a nice base for Mexi. We see a nice 2 major road lines going through his farms, and his corn consuming buildings are located just above the farms. All coal consuming buildings are very close to the coal, with the exception of metallurgists, which are a bit out of the way. That could come to some problems if he runs out of coal. It's a long game. Imagine how long it'll take to get this coal all the way up here. That would very, very much be a problem. And interesting, going for a tower down here, maybe to hope to somehow pick off any stray horses that come by to go scout him. And for some reason, doing double roads here. I don't know why he felt the need to do it. Perhaps he's planning on doing a lot of trading in this game. But overall, very fine performance. You'll see his iron production is going to be mid-30s. And already transitioning out of bows and getting an additional mix of melee. Having a larger amount of melee is very nice in one-on-one because it's so important that you don't get outflanked. And it's very easy to do so if you outnumber your enemy with melee units. And we'll pause it here. That's all she wrote. I wish I was just a moment sooner because I don't know how many knights Mexi made. Let's take a note of that. Perhaps you can rewind the video and look just a moment ago when I was on the barracks. And hopefully you can deduce what his actual count of knights was. But I'm thinking he made 3-ish. No, just one. I think he's only made one knight so far. But it's not exactly important. This will give you a good idea of what he's done. I want to emphasize that peacetime armies, even a one-on-one, are not super important. It's important that your base is working really well. And although if you have 43 recruits, that is a problem. Although Mexi, not so many either. Anyway, but you'll see that both these armies are very close. Close enough. But anyway, I wanted to continue elaborating on the peacetime army. Players do like to have a nice peacetime army for the sake of comparing the quality of the build. And it's the easiest way to compare how good your build was. Because in the end, it is a military game. It is a war game. Your army is the most important factor. And lately, or in the recent past, there were lots of competitions on who could get the largest amount of soldiers at 60 minutes, and that was the entire point of playing, just seeing how much military you could get in that time. Anyway, we'll get going. But anyway, players like to compete for the best peacetime armies, what you have at 60 minutes. So I will continue to pause. I hadn't been doing that in the past, but I'll start doing it again. Look at the exploration. Always very important to pay attention to your knights. A few knights makes the difference in fights. But having good vision is even more important in some situations, so it can be worth it to go explore the enemy base, even if you know you'll lose your knight doing so. We'll get this going a bit faster. Here we see Mexican is already working on additional coal mines and continuing to expand in his base. Important on a one-on-one. You can't rely on anyone else's economy to keep going. Koczis is capitalizing on his second supply of coal being much closer. I would say the coal would be here if we wanted to keep it balanced, but it's established that Mexican's location is weaker. I don't like this tower only because it's not guarding a lot of area, and it's going to be difficult to defend. The towers are almost pointless if you can't defend the tower. But this area itself is hard to get enough troops in to defend it, so whatever. If he felt he needed another tower there, then I don't know where else he would have put it. I personally just wouldn't have made it in the first place. This tower here is much better. Crush them. Okay, Koczis was a little too brave there, a little too ballsy, and tried to pick off some Mexican knights, but was unable to slaughter them in time. I didn't completely view it, so if that's not what you were trying to do, Koczis, go ahead and dislike the video. As I'm sure you will anyway. This is when I will really start to worry about Mexicans' gold production. Should be more worried on the fight here. But this is a long way to haul these bags of coal, and the serfs don't like taking things further than... Well, they like to take things to closer areas first. Not always, but they tend to favor that. Okay, so we'll pause the battle right here. Koczis is trying to click in too many different spots. Perhaps he's focusing on his lance carriers at the very moment, at this very moment, because his swords are out of the fight and he's going to lose all his knights for nothing, really. He shouldn't have been engaged at the moment. You want to wait a little bit longer because these are just going to be evaporated. Turn off the speed and keep the game going. All soldiers are engaged. So you won't be able to see any flank. Oh, these guys are not engaged, so these guys can flank and protect the flank. And now Mexi's going to lose all his knights because they are on lance carriers, and that's not the ideal fight. Now, Koczis' bowmen right here, I want to point out, are actually in a much better position than Mexicans' bowmen. So Koczis actually took a really good position here. Why are these bows so much stronger? Well, after these soldiers in the middle have been evaporated, these guys only have one target, and that's this area right here. The fewer targets your bowmen have, the more powerful they will be because of their somewhat ridiculous AI where they choose to target randomly from their host of targets. This could simulate a bowman being somewhat inaccurate to pick off individual soldiers in a fight, and they'd rather aim in a cluster of units. But what this results in game, in practical terms, is that they will focus fire individual units. Now, these guys are going to be shot down really quickly and evaporate. Now, this cascades into a host of other things happening. For example, if the bowmen are targeting random soldiers, by the time they manage to hit another guy for a second time, or the same guy a second time, he may have already healed and has his life point back. So the bowmen are almost doing nothing at that point. If they're focus firing one guy before he gets a chance to heal, he's dead. In addition, these guys on the flank are going to be cut down so quickly where, let's suppose there are still sword fighters here. A moment ago in the fight there were. These guys are going to be focused fire down quickly, and this flank of Koczis right here will be able to sweep around and clean up the rest of Mexi soldiers. Mexican already realizes, well, it's obvious at this point, his entire melee line is down, and he needs to save his bows if he has any chance to defend. And he's going to be able to get out of here. He's very fortunate in that Koczis' knights all were slaughtered. If it wasn't for that, then these bows would have a much harder time surviving. So that fight might have looked like it went really bad for Mexican, but he has more than enough troops to defend. He's going to have to take a good fights from here on out. And that or surpass Koczis' economy. It's still being Brangelo. He does not want to flee completely into his base. So he's still being somewhat aggressive, but very willing to fall back to the safety of his towers. He is outnumbered. Koczis does not have horses. I wonder why. And here was a good engagement from Mexican. He killed off a few more than he lost. Small exchange, but those can add up quickly. Or at least over time. Koczis is expanding his bakery production. Still having trouble keeping his people fed. See, he was also building another farm down here. Mexican's food production is strangely doing a bit better. Could be because of the fish. That's probably because of the fish. This is enough fish for two locations, and unfortunately, it's hard to prevent players from doing that in one-on-one. Taking more than their allotted resources. That was a very good engagement for Mexi. Unfortunately, some of it is just luck, hoping that your bowmen get the kill on the first shot. But Koczis is pushing a little too hard there, perhaps, and you can definitely see that the numbers are starting to even out. In fact, I would almost say Mexican's army is a bit stronger. Definitely more sword fighters for Koczis, but I really like knights. I tend to overvalue them, perhaps, but it's very hard to do anything with your army if you don't have horses. And now Koczis is really just trying to get the game going, and oh my goodness, he's got a little flank here, which is actually kind of nice. It prevents these guys from moving back. But without bows, these are all just going to be evaporated. This is good positioning on the bows, I think, if he can get them all shooting. Right here would be the optimal position, I think. Mexican mistakenly, or rather, has his horse a little too far out of the fight there. But overall, considering Koczis is the one that pushed that, he's doing rather well. The aggressor always has a disadvantage in Knights and Merchants. Alright. So either Koczis had more than I realized, or he just did well in that fight. Really well, considering, again, he attacked. These towers no doubt had stones in them. So they, probably got a few kills as well. At this point, if I was Koczis, I would be really comfortable getting my army to right here. This would kill off these woodcutters and at least delay, hurt Mexican's economy a little, but at least would help pay off for the losses he had on attacking his base. Unfortunately, Koczis felt the need to withdraw pressure, whether he was looking in his base or whatever. And this enables Mexican to get his serfs safely inside the towers with stones. Let's look at this here. I was wondering what he was building down here, and I guess, yeah, obviously just towers. I do like what Koczis is doing, keeping his militia away from the bows. They're not going to do anything unless they get some flanking action in. Oh my goodness, Koczis is pushing again without his bows. But anyway, he's also withdrawing them very quickly when the knights get over. The knights would just tear this to shreds. So he's being positioning these well and keeping them active and moving around. I think... Is Koczis thinking about feeding his swords? He knows he saved more swords in that first fight than Mexican, so he's probably wanting to feed his army. So Mexi feeling brave. Probably has more than Koczis at this point. But for all intents and purposes, it's pretty even numbers-wise. Or power-wise, because... even if Koczis does have more soldiers, Mexican still has the knight's advantage. Koczis could supply his army with a bit more. And so could Mexi. For whatever reason, Koczis feel the need to withdraw, though. So we'll see Mexican control a bit more of the map here. Another advantage the defender has is he's able to get his reinforcements to the fight faster. That's unfortunate. Perhaps that could be alleviated a little bit if soldiers moved quickly, more quickly, but what are you going to do? Okay, and now, with the fish out, Mexi is building vineyards over his old coal mines. You can see his food production is starting to reflect a lower amount, and I assume Koczis is, well, still not looking extravagant, but his food is, I don't doubt it has any issues. Neither player feeling overly brave, but they're still making maneuvers, so that's always good. I want to look at the distribution of wares for Mexican before this fight starts. You can see he is heavily focusing on getting coal to these metallurgists, which will encourage the serfs to supply these a bit more, and that's good. You can see here, though, that these are really piling up on coal. Could probably use an extra 10 serfs, but my goodness, 88 is already a hefty number. Anyway, we'll turn the speed off and look at this. You see, again, Koczis' bows are a little out of the fight, but it won't take long for them to get into the optimal position. I don't know exactly where the best spot for these bows would be. Probably up here, if you could get them all together. But if that was the case, Mexican wouldn't be trying to engage. He would be falling back at that point. So let's talk practical purposes. Mexicans' bows are all centrally located, so they can react to whichever the part of the fight they want. Lots of reinforcements down here, able to protect the flank. In that case, if I were Mexican, I would probably leave maybe one knight over here and the axe fighters to guard the flank, along with some help with these lance carriers, and bring these knights into the fight. split them right before the fight and try to harass the bows from all sides. And if I were Koczis, I would really try to do something with these militia, or at least try to get them behind the lines, but it's going to be really hard with these soldiers here. Okay, interesting. Koczis is deciding to fight this here. Mexican making a really good choice not to engage up there, because he wants to wipe all this out. So the flank threat has been eliminated, and Koczis don't throw... Okay, I thought he was going to storm. Okay, this fight is not going well for Koczis. Focus too hard on the flanking here, I think, and his bows aren't shooting. Mexican's got some bows not shooting either, but these knights are just going to clean up. Okay, I think a good way for Koczis to cut his losses, he didn't engage these melee units with his swords and instead caught the knights, so that's going to help his bowmen stay alive. So, a very good saving grace from Koczis. Hopefully he can kill these knights before... Okay, very good. That's going to help him a lot. And he's actually going to be able to keep fighting. He's got these swords here. And he's going to be able to shoot these melee units away. So this is going to prolong the game even further. But very good a way for Koczis to redeem himself in the end of that fight. Able to pick off the rest of Mexican's melee. And we are even yet again. But neither player still showing willing to withdraw. And oh my goodness, perhaps Koczis or Mexican should have withdrew because he is really not ready for these horses. Decent amount of fresh troops coming for Koczis. And Mexican will be able to bring in another group soon. He wants melee though, and he has it. Lots of swords that he can bring into the fight. Excuse me. It's worth noting at this point that you probably want to stop making sword fighters, at least that personally I would, because with the low amount of iron left on the map, I would want to save that for knights. Knights are a very strong unit, and scouts are essentially worthless. It's just a slightly stronger axe fighter, but with a huge weakness to lance carriers and pikes. Yes, you'll still be able to run down bowmen, but they can't hold up in a fight any better than a group of axe fighters, really. Especially considering in the late game, you're going to see a lot more lance carriers on the map. Now, you can always trade, which these players are doing. Probably Koczis as well. He's still trading for food, surprisingly. And actually, that's a big advantage. If you don't have to use your market for trading for food, you can do exactly what Mexican is doing, which is the ultimate trade, wooden shield for one iron ore, or one gold ore, or one coal, respectively. You can also trade one wooden shield to bread. It's a nice trade. One wooden shield to one corn. Nice trade. And this is not a nice trade for Koczis, but he's not going to lose anything there. But anyway, Mexican's going to keep his iron production sitting there pretty for a while, and if Koczis doesn't start trading for iron, well, you know as well as I that it will run out soon. Koczis feeling a little weak, so he is going to be falling back to the safety of his towers. And a huge brigade of fresh troops for Mexi. Almost time to turn a second swordsmith on. And that's looking unfortunate for Koczis. That amount of fresh troops is going to make it difficult. What is going on? Why is Koczis getting outnumbered so much right now? He's got three weaponsmithies, or weapons workshops. Mexi has four. And that's going to be a big difference. Koczis has four sawmills, and Mexi has five. Mexi has five armory workshops, but he's trading shields away. So, yeah, undoubtedly, Mexi with a bigger economy. Two more woodcutters as well. So that's the explanation right there. I like how Mexican wasn't afraid of these axe fighters, knowing that his knights can clean them up, but... Ugh. His bow stopped shooting, and that's really, he really didn't need to bring them all the way up there. Now they're too close to the fight, and they stopped shooting, and again, that's, this is gonna be a good fight for Koczis. I really don't think he should have kept stopped his bows from shooting there. It looked like where, the fight went wrong, I think. And again, his bows are running around too much, I think. But I could be missing something. Perhaps there's a reason why Mexican really felt the need, like he needed to move his bows around. And he's got more bows coming, but that's not going to save him right now. These knights are going to be... Well, he's going to lose all these bows, probably. He will lose all these. No doubt about that. And Koczis is doing the right thing. He's got nothing to lose and everything to gain with these, so he's going to bring his bowman away. Mexi's going to do a try to cut his losses and get some bowman. And Koczis knows what he's up to, so he's moving his bowman well out of harm's way. And Mexi's got a feeble looking force left, so Koczis only needs to push and he can win this. But these towers are very well set up. again, this one, I don't really enjoy towers that are right up against the mountain, but it is also out of the way for military, and he can hold it right here. This is probably guarding this area more than anything else. Less so this area, probably. But I have a feeling that that tower will find its use when Koczis pushes on this base. If Koczis pushes on this base. Now, let's look at this. Is Mexi having trouble with his metallurgists? I might have called that. At this point, there's a spot screaming, put the metallurgists here. I would say do so. He's got plenty of coal left in these mountains. And these ones aren't getting anything done. And when you have 12 axes, 6 swords... An army could be better used up here. So at this point, yeah, you want to make your third metallurgist. But Mexi does not like it. Yeah, I don't know if I've ever seen him do it. But come on, you can't deny it. At this point, this is what. He's even trading his axes away for gold. He's craving it so hard. There's no denying another metallurgist down here would be a big help for his economy. And he's not building anything, so what's the harm? Doesn't even need to make a road for it. Just click easy. Look away.
Quiet at will.
It's still looking pretty even. Despite Mexican having trouble getting gold out, he's able to keep up with Koczis. And it could be that these extra weapons you see here all are mostly because of, mostly because of those extra sawmills and extra weapons workshops. He's building another stable. Okay, Koczis did a nice job snaring that flanking unit there. And okay, we're going to find another fight here. I'll talk about that stable more in a moment, hopefully. Koczis getting good engagements here and there. Mexican's bows are nicely placed. Not optimally, I would say. Maybe a few steps back would be better. And Koczis clearly coming up on top there, but he's got towers to fall back on. And ooh. Ah, this is... this is really bad for Mexi. Able to get the soldiers caught near the tower, which is great. Stationary targets are much easier for towers, but... that's the last of his melee. He really needs that at the moment. Does the smart thing. He makes swords. I was going to say that he's going to save those swords and make 10, 15 knights. Two stables are going to pound out horses really quickly. And I'm wondering if that's what his plan was, to just come out with a host of knights and surprise Koczis. Well, the game continues. Pause it for a moment. I'm curious. Well, I don't need to pause it. I'll just play. Did Mexi make more farms? He made one more farm. I'm curious. I think Koczis probably, yeah, Koczis produced more food at the end. The end of the day. If you're wondering why this guy isn't fighting, it's because this bush here is actually blocking him. And that's something to keep in mind, actually. Koczis doing the smart thing and actually splitting his knights up. The purpose of that was so they didn't get caught on this knight ear and wrapped around... trying to flank. This tower would have a few knights off, and that would have been an unfortunate and unnecessary loss. 30 recruits in this barracks, and that would have to be good game. And here we are, these metallurgists are working nicely. Did he make more serfs? No, he didn't. But, well, for whatever reason, they seem to be working well at the moment. I feel there's not going to be engagement for a while, so we'll speed it up. Pretty good push from Koczis. Did he lose a knight there? I'm not so sure. He may have. If he did, then... not great push, but I did notice some good bow kills there. Being really brave with his knights. I'm getting a little too close there, perhaps. This guy is hungry enough where I would consider splitting him out and feeding him. Koczis Koczis must be out of iron. Only explanation for making scouts. I'm surprised Mexican is going for this. Well, Koczis isn't shooting, so there's nothing to lose. He's just going to cut his losses there and leave. Probably a good idea. At this point, obviously, he's got to, but... losing all that melee for nothing is... and no bows? He might even get caught here. Oh, no, never mind. Darn. I'll slip up from Koczis. He really... oh my goodness, he did get caught. He stormed. And we have a knight up here. This is, yeah, it's a bummer from Koczis. Oh my goodness. I think it was a good move from Koczis, actually. He's able to get Mexican's knights out of the picture. Hopefully he gets that last one, too. Really needs to get that last knight out. He didn't. And that's a bummer. Good storm from Mexican. He knows all the melee threats are out of the picture. He only needs to breach these defenses, and he's got this game. But, Coach, let's be honest here. These are some nice towers from Koczis, and I see this, and I think those are some good towers. And, oh, but Mexican choosing not to go through the gauntlet and going up through here, where he's got more, more space to maneuver. And this has got to be a good game. There's no way Koczis is going to be able to hold this. Does he have more melee? He does not. And does Mexi have more coming? He does indeed. But he does flee. He does not know how many towers are up here. Okay, so he's just scouting this. Okay, so Koczis is still in this for sure. He was probably just up here to see if he had towers. If he didn't have towers, then yeah, he would have just walked in. And Mexican doesn't know for sure how much Koczis has. But he's got to know that he's short on melee. Okay, he's coming back up here. Is he gonna go in? Okay, he's emptying his tower, which is the right thing to do. You can empty a tower by moving a knight back and forth. It's almost an exploit, but it's probably good that it's in the game. Always a fan of offensive strategies. And we see Koczis is resupplying his lines, but this is a huge chunk of soldiers here. And it's going to be hard to hold us back, but it's not over yet. I called it a moment ago, but it's not over yet. But it's looking pretty scary. Looks like Mexi figured out his gold problems, and he's got plenty of soldiers here. There goes that knight. Okay, this is not ideal. Losing everything there. And an axe fighter. But Koczis doesn't want to show weakness. He doesn't want to show that he's scared, because he doesn't want Mexican to be any more confident than he already might be at this point. But Koczis realizes if this army was to storm here, here it might get slaughtered. There's so many stones here. Assuming, two stones kill, and that's probably being generous. You have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. If every tower kills two soldiers, that's Mexican's army right there, or the bulk of it. But not every tower is going to hit him. Not every tower is even going to get a chance to shoot, so. But still, just a rough idea. Even more and more and more melee, and here come the militia. Mexican won't be afraid to throw them at towers, I'm sure, as long as they have some support against the archers. This hungry tower is... Koczis did a smart thing by putting his inn down here. That's gonna make sure his recruits get fed and back to the towers quickly. Mex T doesn't know he has an inn here. So all he knows is that this recruit is hungry. And these recruits, these militia here are just craving to storm these towers. He sees the other tower here, so Mexican knows there's two towers there. Will this guy come back from lunch break soon enough? Oh my goodness. Let's talk about awesome things that happen. Because of the way the traffic was on this road, the recruit actually left the building walking onto grassland. Now, if they walk onto the grass, they don't try to go back onto the road as quickly as possible. Instead, they'll just find the quickest route to their home. So because he was bumped off the road, he didn't bother walking all the way around. And those couple seconds could make a difference. In this case, Koczis is going to have his recruit come back to his tower in time. Hopefully, in time to kill some militia. Yeah, he's going to get there, but he wouldn't have if he went around, which is... In the end, it's not going to make a difference because these are militia, but that's it's a funny little thing that happened there. These towers are nearly empty. Not going to get any meaningful kills here. And Koczis' bowmen are not where they need to be, to put it bluntly. Oh, okay, so here we go. Coach is going to get some flanking in, hopefully. But Koczis' army is eradicated, and that is good game. So I hope you enjoyed it. We'll look at the stats here in a moment. I'm going to go definitely with Mexican having the stronger economy, just because he had so many more buildings. But Koczis had more food produced at the very least. Yeah, you can see he was comfortably ahead in all production stats. But food, Koczis, yeah, he had a little bit more food produced. The fish, though, this is just unethical. That early game bonus from the fish is pretty nice. You can see everything pretty neck and neck. Hand axes. You can see this is the militia that Mexican made. Well, these are pretty high numbers, so... Yeah, that wasn't just that group of 20 militia. Who was trading axes for food? Was that Koczis, I think? Yeah, I think that was Koczis. Did Mexican really have that many axe fighters? I don't remember seeing so many, but I guess so, huh? I know he traded a lot of wooden shields away, so I'm not going to rely on that graph too much. Let's see, the leather graph here is pretty similar. Everything is really close, with Mexi just being a little bit ahead. You can see this is the double baker Koczis went for. Corn, very neck and neck. Wine barrels, Koczis didn't make wine. And here it is. This is what made the difference in the game, almost undoubtedly. well, the fights made the difference there at that second to last fight. But this is huge. Koczis stop making gold at the end, and can't reinforce if you don't have gold. Mexican still getting a trinket of iron in at the end. But you can see everything flattening off, and this would have gone into the very late game with almost no iron units on the map. Two more woodcutters. Really helping Mexican make the difference there. When the game is this close, Mexican's economy was stronger, but I would say Koczis took the better fights. And it doesn't look like it because Koczis, I mean, he had all of his army eradicated at the end. But if you look just 15 minutes before the end, Koczis had slightly better kills. If you take off those last two fights, it would be interesting to see. I wish you could rewind and I would go look to see what the stats were right there. But I would say Koczis probably had at least 20 to 25-ish extra kills on Mexi at that point. And it took one bad fight from Koczis, it looks like, to lose this game for him. So unfortunately, for Koczis, that's a 2-0 on the channel for Mexi. And maybe he'll get a third time's charm. These guys played a lot of one-on-one matches back in the day. I'll continue looking through my replay folder, and if you guys like the one-on-one, maybe I'll do another shoutcast of that and upload it. Most one-on-one games, Dan, pretty quickly are uninteresting, at least. So I don't always upload them. Don't always like watching them. But this one was pretty good. I remember, I watched this game some time ago, I admit, but I don't remember what the ending, I didn't remember what the ending was, and all I know is I saved it as an interesting game, so. Indeed, I thought it was interesting, I hope you enjoyed it too, and I'm done rambling and coughing into the mic now, so you all have a good day, and we'll see you back for another shoutcast later.